Hello. For this demonstration, I would like to discuss the topic of classification of living organisms. So here in this video, we are going to describe, we are going to have the overall idea of the classification of living organisms. So basically, in this video, we are going to have the idea of what exactly the classification is and why do we classify, and followed by what is the binomial nomenclature. That means it is the system of giving scientific names to the individual living organisms. So we are going to have the concept of binomial nomenclature, and we'll be proceeding towards the hierarchy of the classification. That means what are the different taxonomic levels in the classification. We are going to discuss that also, and followed by the history of classification. That means from ancient time to the recent past, what are the different classifications that are existed, that are popular, that became popular by different scientists. We are going to discuss all these different classifications, and followed by five kingdom classification. So this five kingdom classification is nothing but classifying all living organisms into five kingdoms respectively. So this is the popular idea of classifying organisms. All these things would be covered in this video. So coming to the first point, so in order to understand all these things, first we need to understand what is classification. So here, what is classification? So classification is nothing but sorting out all living organisms into similarity groups. That means based on their similarities, maybe based on the differences also, based on the differences with the other such groups. So we are going to classify or divide organisms into individual groups and subgroups. That is what the classification is. So here, based on the similarities and differences among all living organisms, they are arranged into different groups and subgroups, and this process is nothing but the classification. So that is what called as classification is. The organisms are arranged into different groups and subgroups. So at different taxonomic levels, or one such unit is called as taxon. So at different taxonomic levels, the organisms are classified. That is what the classification is. So the next question is, why we need to classify living organisms? So what is the importance of classifying organisms? So in order to understand that, basically there are many species are living on earth, sharing this earth. So there are millions and trillions of living beings. So in order to study them independently, individually, it is very hard, and it is almost next to impossible. We cannot study and understand characteristic features of all living organisms. So what we need to do is group them into similar groups. So in one group, all organisms present on that group may be sharing similar characteristic features. So based on the such characteristic features, take any organism, it will have the similar properties. So it is easy to understand and study organisms in that way. So that is what the importance of the classification. That is why we do classify living organisms. So it is impossible to study all living organisms individually, but grouping them at different levels makes them easy to understand, study and understand their characteristic features. Hence, we do classify living organisms. So the next concept is the binomial nomenclature. So here we discussed why we need to classify organisms and what exactly is the classification is. But for classifying organisms, and for this classification, it is easier if we have a common acceptable name all over the world. So for any organism, the different languages are existed. So one organism is called in one way in one language. If you go to the next place, the organism may be same, but that would be called with the other name. So in order to avoid such confusion, we need to have some common acceptable scientific names to the all organisms. Before classifying all organisms, we need to have scientific names in our hand so that we can simply classify them. So here comes the binomial nomenclature. Binomial nomenclature is the system of giving scientific names to the individual living beings. So here, this system is first put forward by Carolus Linnaeus. So he is the scientist who proposed this concept called binomial nomenclature. He mentioned it in his book called Systema Naturae. So for his contributions, he regarded as father of taxonomy. And here, the name indicates binomial nomenclature. Bi means two and nomial indicates the name. So here, for every scientific name, there would be two parts or two names should be mentioned in the scientific name of an organism. So what are the two parts? Here, all scientific names are mostly derived from Latin because that is the root language. So there would be two parts in each name of living organisms. So all living organisms must be called with two names, two parts in its scientific name. So the first name or first part represents its genus, and the second part represents its species. So here we should mention genus name also and also the species name. First comes the genus and followed by the species name. And another rule in the binomial nomenclature is when you write down the name, scientific name of an organism, it should be written in the italics. That means slanting way. And here, when handwritten, the first letter of the first part, that means first letter of the genus, must be capitalized. So these are the rules that present in the binomial nomenclature, the concept of binomial nomenclature. So take an example of human being which have the scientific name called Homo sapiens. Homo means it is the name of our genus. So Homo is genus and sapiens is the species. So when handwritten, the H must be in capital form because this is the first letter of the first part or the genus name, and all the remaining letters should be in the small letters, and all these must be written in italics. So these are the rules. And coming to the hierarchy of classification, that means what are the different taxonomic levels in the classification. Here, for every scientific name which consists of genus and species, that means species is the lowest rank in the taxonomy. That means this is the lowest taxon. So species is the group of organisms which can integrate, that means which can reproduce among themselves to give healthy offspring. So that is what the species is. So here, species is group of living organisms. So all people living on earth, all of us are belongs to the sapient species. So here, genus may be group of species. That means there can be one or two species in the genus, or maybe more, so which are having some common features that shared among them. And family consists of different genus, and different orders consist of some families, and class consists of different orders, and phylum consists of different classes, and kingdom consists of the different phyla. So basically, this kingdom is the highest rank in the classification, and there are very limited number of kingdoms present. That means very few kingdoms are present, and in each kingdom there are many phyla. In each phyla there are many classes. In each class there could be many orders, and each order may have many families in them. And each family may consist of different genus, and each genus may have different species. So according to that, the classification will be carried. So basically, what is the history of classification? That these things are the different taxonomic levels in the classification. So maybe we belongs to the kingdom Animalia and phylum Cardata, and followed by maybe mammals, maybe in vertebrates, and the family is something else. So like that, we do classify organisms. So basically, from ancient time, the classifications are put forward. That means different people classified living organisms in different way. So here comes the first one of the earliest classification that is proposed by famous scientist called Aristotle. So Aristotle is classified organisms into the two groups, plants and animals. So this is one of the earliest classification. For his contribution to the biology, Aristotle is considered as the father of biology, and he is also father of the zoology. So basically, he classified living organisms into plants and animals. And these plants are subdivided into herbs, shrubs and trees. That means based on the morphology, based on the size of the plant, he subdivided plants into herbs, shrubs and trees. So he also subdivided the animals into the two categories. One may be with red blood cells, red blood, and one without the red blood. So based on the type of blood, the color of blood, he also subdivided animals into two categories. And he also considered another criteria to classify the animals, that is based on their habitats. That means the place where do the animal live. So an animal could be aquatic, terrestrial or aerial. So these are the three kinds of places or habitats we can find the animals. So he also classified animals based on their habitat. So coming to the main demerit of the Aristotle classification is basically animals like amphibians, which can survive also on land, which can also survive in water. That kind of amphibians, such as frogs, couldn't come under proper taxon. So we cannot place these kind of amphibians into any type of the groups among the three groups that can be possible based on their habitat of the animal. So that is one of the major demerit of the Aristotle classification. So the next famous scientist who contributed to the classification of taxonomy is the Theophrastus. So Theophrastus made profound contributions to the field of botany. That means he is a botanist who studied plants, and he considered as the father of botany. So he studied 480 plants. That means he described and he gave scientific names to the 480 plants in his book called Historia Plantarum. He also classified plants into four groups, which are herbs, shrubs and undershrubs and trees. These are the four groups based on the Theophrastus classification of plants. So next comes the two kingdom classification. So here the two kingdom classification, as name indicates, the organisms are divided into two kingdoms. So Carolus Linnaeus proposed it. So he is the same scientist who proposed the binomial nomenclature. He also proposed the two kingdom classification. So basically, living organisms are divided into two kingdoms based on their mode of locomotion and nutrition. That means whether they can move or not, and based on their nutrition, that means how do they get their food, whether they prepare their own food like plants, or maybe whether they they depend on the other organism for their food, that such as heterotrophs, which are animals. So based on the nutrition and mode of locomotion, he classified organisms into Animalia and Plantae, two kingdoms, Kingdom Animalia and Kingdom Plantae. Here still these two kingdom classifications have demerits. So such classification is not not giving justification to the living organisms which are unicellular or prokaryotic. So here, prokaryotes are primitive organisms which cannot be considered either as animal or as plant. And also primitive eukaryotes are also another group which are unicellular. We cannot say simply put them in either in plant or in animals. So these it couldn't distinguish unicellular and multicellular organisms. It couldn't explain the position of prokaryotes. These are the main disadvantages or demerits. So a large group of organisms doesn't fit into the above categories. So organisms such as Euglena doesn't have place in either of the kingdoms according to two kingdom classification. So next comes the three kingdom classification. So here, a German scientist called Ernest Haeckel in the year of 1886 proposed three kingdom classification. So here, the three kingdoms are Kingdom Plantae, Kingdom Animalia and Kingdom Protista. So these are the three kingdoms. So according to Ernest Haeckel, the living organisms either were divided into Plantae, Animalia and Protista. He added this kingdom Protista, in which he suggested the protozoans, fungi, bacteria would be included, and also some other microbes will also be included in kingdom Protista. So kingdom Protista consists of unicellular organisms which are either prokaryotes or eukaryotes. So this is what the three kingdom classification is. So next comes the five kingdom classification, which is proposed by American scientist called R.H. Whitaker. So here, R.H. Whitaker classified organisms into five kingdoms, as name indicates, five kingdoms. So here, the kingdoms, five kingdoms here are Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae and Animalia. So here, for all organisms, all living organisms are properly grouped into these five kingdoms. So what are the criteria, what are the different factors he considered for the classifying organisms into five taxonomical groups? So these factors are based on cell type, based on the cell wall, type of cell wall present in them, based on the nuclear membrane, that means whether it is absent or present, based on the body organization, that means whether it is a simple and unicellular or complex or multicellular organism, and also based on the mode of nutrition, whether it is able to prepare its own food, that means whether it is an autotroph, or it is depending on the other organisms for its food needs, that means whether it is a heterotroph. So based on all these criteria, with what is the cell type, what is the cell wall, type of cell wall present in it, whether nuclear membrane is present or absent, whether the body organization is simple or complex, and what is the mode of nutrition of an organism. So based on all these characters, he divided all organisms into five kingdoms respectively. So what are those? So here comes the Kingdom Monera. Kingdom Monera is the group in which very primitive early organisms, that means bacteria are present, comes under kingdom Monera. So basically these prokaryotes, it consists of truly prokaryotes, all these are prokaryotes without nuclear membrane, without proper nucleus. These are the organisms present without proper nucleus and without proper cellular organelles. So they don't have chloroplasts, they don't have mitochondria or any other membrane bound organisms or organelles, cell organelles are absent in this kingdom Monera. So Monera consists of primitive organisms like bacteria, which are prokaryotes, which are unicellular, they don't have nucleus. And coming to their mode of nutrition, they can be autotroph or heterotroph. So based on the presence of pigment, photosynthetic pigment, they might be either autotrophic or heterotrophic. And cell wall is present in Monerans. So the next comes the kingdom Protista, which are a bit advanced than this kingdom Monera. And this kingdom Protista consists of unicellular organisms, but these are eukaryotic organisms. That means nuclear membrane is present, cell organelles are present in the cell. And these might be autotrophic or heterotrophic, that means mode of nutrition could be anything. And these are having cell wall. In some, these are not having cell wall. In some organisms they have, and in some other organisms they don't. And the mode of nutrition was also, it could be autotrophic in some and heterotrophic in some other organisms. So these are called protists. And the next kingdom is kingdom fungi. So this kingdom fungi ranges from very small little eukaryotic cells, that means unicellular organisms like yeast, to the very well grown, which are visible without microscope, such as mushrooms. And they also consist of mold. So such large kingdom is kingdom fungi. So all these are not autotrophs, that means photosynthetic pigment is absent. And this kingdom fungi consists of organisms which are having variety of nutrition. So they can be heterotrophic nutrition. In some members they mostly depend on the dead and decaying materials, and those are called saprophytes. And some organisms maybe they infect the other living organisms for the food needs, hence they are also called as parasites. So they ranges from heterotrophs, saprophytes and parasites. These three categories are also included in the kingdom fungi. So the next kingdom is the kingdom plants. So kingdom Plantae is the largest kingdom which have all living plants on the earth. So here they may be from very small plants such as algae to the very large plants such as broadleaf tree, flowering trees, which lives for many, many years, hundreds of years, which can survive. So such large group of organisms comes under kingdom plants. So what are the common features? All these are multicellular organisms. All the members of kingdom Plantae are autotrophic, that means they can prepare their own food. They have photosynthetic pigment called chlorophyll, so they can prepare their own food. And all these are multicellular, complex level, their body organization at its complex level. And also these are having cell wall which is made up of cellulose. So that is the common feature among the kingdom Plantae. So in the next comes the kingdom Animalia. This kingdom Animalia includes all animals present on earth. So that may be as small as sponge to the as large as the elephant or maybe a horse or maybe a human being. Such complex organisms are included in kingdom animals. So the common features of kingdom animals is kingdom Animalia is basically all these are multicellular and all these are eukaryotes. Body organization is at its complex level. These organisms, kingdom animals, all animals are heterotrophic in its nutrition. That means they need to be dependent on the other animal or plant for their food needs. They cannot synthesize or they cannot prepare their own food. These are not autotrophs, unlike the plants. So these are the basic common features of the five kingdoms, kingdom Monera to kingdom Animalia. So these are the five kingdoms that are proposed by that all living organisms can be grouped into either of these five kingdoms. So by this we discussed what are the different classifications and what exactly is the classification is and what is the importance of classification and how do we give names to the different groups or different organisms that are present that are classified. So that is what the binomial nomenclature is, and we also discussed the hierarchy of the classification, and we also discussed the history of classification, and followed by five kingdom classification. So thank you.